coming up, November the 12th, and encourage you to sign up in the church foyer. So please do that so they'll know how many are coming. Dario and Candace are headed this way, and they're going to leave Tuesday. We'll hopefully be here Wednesday, and then we're going to need some help Thursday, helping them move their stuff out of their truck. They still do not have a place to live, but they're coming on faith that they will find a place, and they're going to be staying right now with Wanda and Phil Sexton for a little while, but they need to get the stuff off the truck and put it in storage, so we might need a few people Thursday to help with that. If you can do it, see me. That'll be awesome. And keep them in prayer. The youth are away with their chaperones today at the Master's Inn and had a youth conference for the week. Keep them in prayer. They'll be coming back today, and they have their youth service tonight. There was over 30 of them gone, so that's one reason we're a little smaller in attendance this morning. Plus, people are still coming in. Remember your shoe boxes. There's still some available, I think, if you'd like to get some, get some and fill them up. I went to the dollar store, Dollar Tree, the other day, and I think for $18, I filled my box, and it was full. It was really full. So thank you, everybody, for homecoming, those who helped with it. That last week, I think that was very well received. Day of Prayer is coming up for WMU, World Day of Prayer. All people are invited, Carlos Chapel. WMU is still collecting chewing gum in the box out to my right out there in the foyer. Bring that, please. And if you don't see any chewing gum in the box, that's because they're getting it out regularly, so little hands don't get in there and pilfer the chewing gum. Need your budget request in by November the 1st. If you're on a committee or a chair of a committee, we need your budget request in for the coming year by November the 1st. All right. Are there any other announcements?
Good morning. October is Pastor Appreciation Week, and I'm not going to say behind that mic. October is a Pastor Appreciation Month, and so when we were trying to consider how to thank George for all the things that he and Miss Ann, because we know that we're only as good as our spouse. We know that with Miss Ann's treatment and George's brother, that it's been stressful. 3, 6 months, year?
Year.
Absolutely. And so we thought it would be appropriate if we gave them an opportunity to go to the Cove, which is the Billy Graham Center, to do a pastor renewal. Because everybody needs to recharge their battery once in a while. Once Dario comes, George is going to be very busy, as we all are, bringing him up to speed. Because it's not only his responsibility, it is our responsibility also to help Dario and bring him into the family. So I guess I would say that, we love George, we love Ann. And so this is an opportunity for you to go to KMBC with Miss Ann, to go to the Cove. And at your convenience, no timetable. So if it's January, February, or something, we're not going to forget it, though. At some point, we'll have to push you that away.
I will go.
So we just, on behalf of KMBC, thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you all for allowing me to be your pastor and putting up with me. I appreciate it. And you won't have to push me. In fact, it's getting less and less the state that you need to be pushing me to take some time off. So I appreciate that very much. Thank you. We look forward to it. I get excited most of the time when I go off to these conferences and I come back energized. I'm excited. And that's an encouragement for you, maybe, to go to a conference occasionally and hear some good Bible teaching and preaching. Got a video. I want to show you about Ben. This is Ben Carson. He was running for president one time. And, I was really hoping he might become the president, but that's not the case.
There is nothing more personal than the relationship between you and God. Even if you don't know Him, you can rest assured that He knows you. It's why, in the very First Amendment to our Constitution, the Founding Fathers explicitly forbid government from impeding the free exercise of religion. We should be grateful because the embrace of Judeo-Christian values was at the forefront of some of our nation's most noble advances, such as the abolition of slavery and segregation. But fast forward to today, and we are witnessing a coordinated assault on religious freedom. The public square, once intended to be a space safe for religion, is now being turned into a safe space where religion is shunned, as well as anything else that might offend someone. Our government, originally created to protect religion, now funds abortion clinics with taxpayer dollars and persecutes individuals and organizations that object to its mandates. Depending upon its members, the United States Supreme Court can be a bulwark against the left's attempts to whitewash God from our society, or it can grease the skids. So I remind you, don't just think about who will sit in the Oval Office for the next 4 years. Think about what type of people will be nominated to sit on the U.S. Supreme Court for the next several decades. Will they protect and defend your relationship with God? Or will they force you to bow first at the altar of Washington, D.C.?
Supreme Court Justice this year, and they have not filled that vacancy yet, and the next president will fill that vacancy. And we need to be mindful of that when we go and vote. But we need to pray more than anything else. We need to pray for our nation to turn around, because no matter who is elected, they will not solve our issues unless our country turns back to God. I think we're in sort of the same situation that ancient Israel was, where they would turn away from God, and God would send destruction until they would repent and turn around. So that's where we are today. And I pray God is still still willing to hear our prayers. I know He is. But we need to be repentant and turn to Him. Let us pray. Father God, we just come today. Pray, Father, now that You would still our hearts and minds, spirits, Father, that we, Lord, would hear Your voice. I need to hear from You today, and I know each and every one of us needs to hear from You. We all come from different situations in life, different needs, different circumstances and situations, and different problems, different hopes, dreams, and joys. But apart from You, Lord, it's all impossible. We need to know You. You tell us that eternal life is to know You intimately, to walk with You and talk with You, to have a relationship. We cannot have that, Father, until we confess our sins and repent of them, turn to You. So I pray this morning, that's what's going to happen right here, right now. We're just going to cry out, cry up. Say, Lord, come. Holy Spirit, come. Descend upon Your people and fill us. Tabernacle among us. Dwell with us. That we would feel Your presence and know You. That we would be encouraged. That we would be convicted. That we would turn to You, repent of our sins, and feel the refreshing joy and love and peace that comes only from Your Spirit as we turn back to You. We pray for a revival to happen right now, right here today, in my life, in all of our lives. Oh, Father God, blow upon us Your fresh spirit wind. Have Your will, have Your way. Be glorified, be honored. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen, amen. If you're able, please stand with us now and let's worship our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ.
Whoa, 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 wh whisper inside that won't let you forget. Hello, my name is Defeat. I know you recognize me. Just when you think you can't win, I'll drag you right back down again till you lost all.
Awesome to be a child of the one true King, and to know that He loves us and cares for us. And man, I tell you, we are so richly blessed. And even when those times aren't happening and we feel like, man, where are all the blessings? We know that Jesus came and died for our sins, and that's all we really need. Our needs are taken care of. It's our wants that sometimes get in our head a little bit. The biggest thing is we need to share this with everybody. Go out to the world and share with them our new hallelujah. They need to know what's going on with that person's life. You know what I mean? So let's continue to lift them up.
Other side.
salvation song. Amen.
That everyone would take a card. If you're a first-time guest with us this morning, we really are glad that you're here. Ask that you take one of these cards and fill it out on the front. And everybody get a card, put your name on the front, and if there are any needs or requests for ministry that you know of, please put those down so our care ministry can attend to those needs. this coming Tuesday. And we invite people to come and be a part of care ministry on Tuesday nights. Let us pray.
Lord, thank you, Lord, for all the blessings you've blessed us with this week. Thank you, Lord, for such a beyond beautiful day today, Lord.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord, for each and every person here. Thank you for this church family and for so much that we're blessed with. Please, Lord, bless this offering for the upbuilding of your kingdom. Bless this service that your will be done. And bless us just to praise, honor, and glorify your name. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. You may be seated.
I ran across this song a couple of weeks ago, and it just spoke to me. It's real simple, but it turns out this song was either written in 1971, which is the year I was born, or that's just the version that I have that I recognize. So between the time that I started practicing this and actually came to be this morning, I've had a sinus infection. So I got a little nasally. So I still practiced, and I just decided, you know what? I just pray that the Lord blesses the song and the message, and that it goes out and it touches people's hearts. And this is going to be my rendition of a 90s grunge rock solo guitar unplugged version of a 1971 country spiritual. Can you guys hear that? All right. And I was lost, but Jesus saved me. He gave his life on Calvary's tree. And though I fail him, he still loves me. Through his grace I've been set free. It was our sin that he died for all mankind, he paid the price. Who are we that he should love us enough to give his life? No, I don't deserve a mansion, 'cause I was born a sinful man. No, I don't deserve a mansion, but Jesus built a home for me in glory land. Through the darkness I have stumbled, but Jesus' light helped show the way. And every soul I've met, I share his story, that they may know his love and but I don't deserve a mansion, 'cause I was born a sinful man. No, I don't deserve a mansion, but Jesus built a home for me in glory. Jesus built a home for me in
has built a home for me in glory
in the hands of two qualified child care specialists going out the door. Very good. Steve, and I go back a lot further than a lot of you guys do. Not quite back to when you were born, Steve, but he used to be the youth minister at my former church, and led praise and worship there some. And anyway, I didn't realize you were so old, though, Steve. So. But I'm catching up with you. Oh, my. Looking this morning at 2 Timothy and Romans, and go back to 1 Timothy one more time. I wanted to remind you that there's a referendum on our ballot this coming, not this Tuesday week. For an alcohol referendum, countywide alcohol referendum, to allow alcohol to be served in any and sold in any part of our county. Many of you may be not aware that it really has only been able to be sold and served in towns, in cities in the county. And so remember that when you go to vote. Because we're talking this morning about Christians should be responsible citizens. And as we're going to see this morning, I believe the founders intended for one of the main requirements, one of the primary requirements of being a good, responsible citizen was to know your Bible and to place your faith in Jesus Christ and in his teachings. By the way, before I even get started this morning, I want to confess my sins. I get passionate about what I believe lots of times, and I get passionate sometimes in my sermons. I get passionate in Bible studies, and you know, it's not that I hate anybody or I'm mad at anybody. Some little children say sometimes, "Why is he so mad?" And I'm not mad. I'm not mad. I'm just passionate about the Word of God, and I need to listen more. I know that, and I need to be sensitive to the Holy Spirit. And so, that all being said, I've been called to preach, and so I try to preach. And I don't always do it the right way. So if you see me doing it the wrong way or you sense it's the wrong spirit, then I would love for you to come tell me that and talk to me. You know, don't talk about me behind my back. I don't like that part. But come to me and tell me, and I'll try to listen to you. People who seek to know the Bible and apply it to their lives in our country are becoming, many of them, under attack in many situations, as Mr. Ben Carson just said. Dr. Eric Walsh, who was for a very brief time a regional public health director in the state of Georgia, before even really his feet touched the ground, he was called into the office. He's a lay preacher, and they said that they wanted him to submit some sermons that he had preached over the weekend to them. And so he submitted a couple of sermons, and two days later he was fired. Not for anything he had done in his job. In fact, he hadn't been on the job that long, but for his sermons. He was a former advisor on the President's Advisory Council for HIV/AIDS. He'd been in California in a similar job at one time. The Attorney General of the state of Georgia wrote him a letter and said, "Please produce a copy of your sermon notes and or transcripts after the first ones." And he refused, saying, "No government has the right to require a pastor to turn over his sermons. I cannot and will not give up my sermons unless I am forced to do so." Reminds me of the mayor of Houston, Texas, who was requiring and subpoenaed pastors' sermons, and they refused to do it at the time. His attorney said that the government was curious about his sermons. He had been delivering sermons on health, on marriage, on sexuality, on world religions, on science and creationism, topics of that type. And so they wanted to see his sermons. And he was. They say that he was not fired because of his beliefs, but it's interesting that they asked for his sermons. And then they fired him shortly thereafter. There's a mall in Sarasota, Florida. This is nothing new. It's just happening a lot more frequently lately. That's sent out in Sarasota, University Town Mall, Town Center Mall, sent out a notice to all the choral groups that normally come and sing during the holiday season, the Christmas season. Said for choral groups, the notice said, the mall prefers no clearly recognizable Christian music, such as carols sung in English, spirituals, or gospels. They have since rescinded that letter because the people raised a little uproar. And that's my point today. If you want to be a responsible citizen, we need to begin to speak up for our values and for our rights. They took prayer out of school. They took Bible reading out of school, public Bible reading. They take the Ten Commandments out of school. And as we sit by and don't speak up, then more and more stuff's going to be taken out. And it's going to quit being taken out of school. It's going to start being, we're going to start being told in church what we can say and what we can't say. So I want to look this morning as this war on Christmas is starting up, the war on Christianity, talking about being a good, responsible citizen, and that means knowing the Word of God. I believe our founders, just about every one of them, if not every one of them, even Jefferson and even Benjamin Franklin would agree with this verse in 2 Timothy 2:15. Be diligent to present yourself approved to God as a workman who does not need to be ashamed, accurately handling the word of truth. This is the New American Standard updated version. The New King James Version says rightly dividing the word of truth. Be diligent. Be prompt, study, labor, endeavor to be approved as a workman of God. To present yourself, to stand before God. And before you stand before God, to be able to stand before people and live the life that the Bible tells us to live, to be full of the Holy Spirit. So present yourself, exhibit your life before God, before human beings. One day we will be called before God a workman. A workman. That means you got a job to know the scriptures and not just to know them, to rightly divide them, to handle them accurately. Not pull a little bit out over here and over here, but know it all. Try to live by it all. The consummate word of God. That you be not ashamed, unashamed, not be disgraced by your lack of knowledge of the Word of God. How many of y'all are ready? I have them in the back. I have the ushers ready to give out tests this morning on the Bible. Pretty simple test. How many of y'all would like to have a test right now? And if you don't pass it, you're in trouble. And we're going to post your marks on the board in the foyer. How many of you want the test? You know, very few of us do. I'm concerned myself sometimes about too difficult a test. Unashamed. Listen, if you don't want a test this morning, then you need to get in the Word of God because there's going to be a test. If not now, one day when you stand before God and present yourself before Him, accurately handling the Word of truth. Rightly dividing the word of truth. The word here is ortho, or from the root of the word ortho, where we get the word orthodontist, and he straightens your teeth. Or orthodox, which means the right doctrine, the correct doctrine, the straight doctrine. So we need to not just know the word, we need to accurately handle it, we need to understand it, we need to perceive it in the correct way, have right understanding, correct straight understanding of the Word of God. There are a lot of churches today, I believe, who are not giving you a straight understanding of the Word of God in their preaching and teaching. The Word of truth. This is the truth. This is the only truth that will set you free. Talking with a barber this week, cutting my hair, got in a little religious discussion. And he said that he believed that all religions basically were good, and it just was dependent on how earnest you were, how sincere you were about your faith. And I said, well, I don't really agree with you, brother. I said, you know, I said, all religions aren't the same. In fact, I said, most religions, every religion except for one, says that you can work your way to heaven, you earn your merit, you're reincarnated into a better life, or your good deeds are laid in a scale with your bad deeds, and if your good deeds outweigh one. I said, none of us, the Bible says, can inherit eternal life. We're all sinners. We all fall short of the glory of God. And so, and I said, the thing about being earnest about it, I said, you know, if people believe God is a monkey and they sincerely believe it with all their heart, does that make it right? You don't you want to tell people, you know, you're missing the boat. Was Adolf Hitler, because he really believed he should exterminate Jews and Slavs and mentally ill people and homosexuals, was he right because he really believed it? You know, that was his God? No. This is the verse, you know, that Awana gets their acronym from, approved workmen are not ashamed. By the way, if you want to know the Word of God, maybe you ought to get in the Word of God. And one of the best ways to get in the Word of God is to become a teacher. You say, well, I don't want to teach people that know as much as I do. Well, I can understand that. Sometimes that gives me a little concern. But you can teach little children. We desperately need people in Awana. You know, some of y'all, I know you're busy. Some of you work. Some of you can't work with these children. Some of you work with them all day long. You sure don't want to work with them one night. But let me tell you, the Bible says you need to study and you need to know the Word of God. And I'm going to tell you, that's one way you'll start learning it, because that's what Awana is all about. Knowing the Word of God.
Since Awana started in August, we've had two kids to give their mother Christ.
Yep, two little kids. That not only the conversions, it's the kids learning the Bible. At a young age, I don't know about y'all, but the things I learn now, I forget pretty quickly. Things I learned when I was a kid, they're there. Okay, that's enough. Shame on us. If we don't know the Word of God, shame on us if we're not correctly handling the Word of God, and we do that by teaching others. And we need some help in Awana. We got a bunch of kids. So, what's the Bible got to do with being a good citizen, huh? Why do you say that? That's wouldn't float in most discussions today. Bible's got a lot to say about citizenship, about praying for those in authority over you, about submitting to those in authority over you. The founders intended that responsible citizens of the United States know and obey the Word of God. And you might object to that saying right now, but we're going to look at a few documents that support that saying. I know there are a lot of historical revisionists today who write textbooks for our children who deny this fact or keep silent about it. You know, They write textbooks and leave God out. They write about the pilgrims and leave God out. And I'm going, how do you write about the pilgrims and leave God out? But they do in our textbooks. Our children are not being taught about the religious foundation of our nation. Not saying our nation's perfect. Just sit back now. Don't get all in a wad. We've done a lot of things wrong. And even the documents that we wrote that are good documents, we didn't follow them like we should. We'll get into that, but I mean, doesn't mean that the documents necessarily were wrong because we weren't following them. I mean, do you follow the Bible totally? The Bible's not wrong in my opinion, but I mess up. Don't do it like I should. That's true of our nation. The founders did not intend for Christianity to have an influence in government. They just didn't want a state church like they had in England or Germany. They didn't want the Lutheran church to be the state church, and that was the official church, and it was really the only one that you could really go to, or in England, the Anglican church or the Catholic church. They didn't want a state church, but they by no means wanted us to divorce our faith from our government. You can't divorce your faith from your life. It should be a part of you. And they wanted it to be a part of this country. Just read the documents. Listen to the United Supreme Court in a ruling in 1844, Vidal versus Girard's executors. Thank you. There is an obligation to teach what the Bible alone can teach. This guy Girard had left a school, some money, and along with the endowment came a desire for the Bible to be taught. And they were bringing this to court that they shouldn't have to teach the Bible. And the Supreme Court of the United States of America said, behind door number one, it's an obligation to teach the Bible. And what have they said in modern days? No, can't do that. Well, that's a misinterpretation of what was intended. The Bible alone, it says, can teach. No other book can teach this like the Bible can teach it. That enough? Not enough for you. Over 100 years later, Supreme Court ruled again in 1892. And they came up with about 80-some precedents here of how our nation had been a Christian nation. Not that everybody was a Christian, not everybody did it like they were supposed to, but we were founded on Christian principles. You know, we had chaplains in the military. They gave over 80-some illustrations. We put our hand on the Bible and say, they swear under oath, so help me God. The Supreme Court begins their session whenever they're in session, every time when the guy comes in, the guardian of arms or whatever he is, it's God save the United States and this honorable court. There are four replicas or representations of the Ten Commandments on or in the Supreme Court building. How can they dare say our nation shouldn't follow the Ten Commandments? This was the ruling. Our laws and our institutions must necessarily, listen to the language here, it's got to be based upon and embody the teachings of the Redeemer of mankind. I love it when people who don't agree with this say, well, it doesn't say Jesus. Duh. Excuse me, I'm getting passionate. I need to preach this in love. They're ignorant, or they want to be ignorant. The Redeemer of mankind is Jesus. It is impossible that it should be otherwise. If we don't base our institutions, is the public school system an institution? Yes. It's impossible that it should be otherwise. And in this sense and to this extent, our civilization and our institutions are emphatically Christian. That means with an emphasis, with a... He goes on and it says, add to the writings and founders of the founders and the laws, their letters, and you come to the conclusion that this is a Christian nation. Governor of Mississippi in the 90s was boo-hooed, ballyhooed, criticized for saying that this was a Christian nation. He was just saying what had been historically true. Not meaning that everybody was a Christian. Not meaning that our government always acted like we were Christians. Meaning that our nation was founded upon the principles contained in the Bible and the teachings of the Redeemer of Jesus Christ. Woo! Mayflower Compact talks about God. Go form a colony that the world can see, a light, a city set on a hill with religious freedom. People didn't come over here and revolt against the king because of taxation. That was a little part of it, but they came over here for religious freedom and morality. The Declaration of Independence
The Jamestown Charter, 1607, talks about God. Every state constitution refers to God or mentions God in their charter. Every state constitution. 1952, Supreme Court, 1952 said the separation of church and state is not what a lot of people are thinking it is, that you can't have faith in government. It's an obligation to teach what the Bible alone can teach. Noah Webster, who wrote our first dictionary, American Dictionary, and wrote many primers and books to educate our children, some of them were around for over 100 years in our nation, said education is useless without the Bible. Education is useless without the Bible. Well, I'm going to tell you, and God bless you teachers for putting up with everything you put up with and you administrators, but let me tell you, according to Noah Webster, if you're not teaching the Bible, it's useless. George Washington said, without God and the Bible, it's impossible to govern. Without God and the Bible, it's impossible to govern. Well, I don't know. George Washington might have been a deist, you know. He sort of believed there was some God somewhere, but not sure he was the real God. No. Abraham Lincoln said the greatest gift given to mankind was the Bible. No. So, amen? Study to show yourself approved, rightly dividing the word of truth. Test time. Name the Ten Commandments. I can't name them in order. Well, don't name them in order. I'll take them upside down. I'll take them any way you want to do it. You know, do we know it? I want it posted on my wall. Well, do you know it? Is it posted on your heart? I mean, this is basic Bible belief 101. First four deal with God. That's how I remember them. Have no other gods before me. Second one, don't make idols or graven images. Don't put anything before me in that sense. Don't take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. Don't take it frivolously. It's serious. When you mention God, it's serious. You know, remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. First four deal with God. Last six deal with people. Honor your father and your mother that your days may be long upon the earth. When they tell you don't go play in the road, don't go play in the road. It's for your own good. Makes sense. Don't murder. Don't commit adultery. Don't steal. Don't covet. Don't lie. Our laws are based on that. Based on the Bible. Recite the Great Commission for me, you know. Y'all know what the Great Commission is? Jesus told his disciples, Matthew 28, go into all the world. Make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and teaching them to observe whatsoever things I've commanded you, and lo, I'm with you always until the end of the world. You need to know that. That's our marching orders. That's why we're here, Christians, to go make disciples. That's what Awana's about. Name the two great commandments. Most of us can do that. Love God with all your heart. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. You cannot love your neighbor as yourself unless you love God with all your heart, because you're going to strangle your neighbor if you can. Love God first. Put him first. He says, if you love me, you will obey my commandments. It's simple. This is simple stuff. You need to know this. If you don't know it today, shame on you. You are not rightly dividing the word of truth. Get home and learn it. Be a workman. Study. Study the word of God. How many of you are going Sunday morning Bible study this morning? I hope all of you are. If you're going, be sure you studied your lesson. Don't sit there and wait for somebody to spoon feed it to you. Romans chapter 13, Bible says a lot about good government and citizenship. Render to all what is due them, tax to whom tax is due, and custom to whom custom, fear to whom fear, honor whom honor. Owe no one anything, oh me, except to love one another, for he who loves his neighbor has fulfilled the law. Submit to the authorities, it says previous to this. For this you shall not covet, commit adultery, you shall not murder, shall not steal, shall not covet. And if there's any other commandment, there are a couple more to ten, don't bear false witness and honor your father and your mother. It's all summed up in this saying, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor, therefore love is the fulfillment of the law. You know, we're all this book here is conditioned on two principles, the two great commandments, love God, love your neighbor. Now, don't sit here and say, well, hey, that's all I got to know. Love God, love my neighbor. Well, how do you know how to love God if you don't know his word? If you don't know what God really loves and what God wants, how can you love God if you don't know the Bible? How can you love your neighbor if you don't know what the Bible tells you, how you respond to your neighbor? So don't sit here and say, well, all I got to do is love people. Well, there's a lot of crazy people out there that think love is all kinds of crazy things.
I love. We in love. 2 years later, you ain't in love anymore. You don't understand what love is.
Our founders came here for freedom. Freedom from immorality. Freedom from wrong. They realized the truth will set you free. And they wrote our Constitution for this purpose. Our Constitution was made for a moral and religious people. It's wholly inadequate for the government of any other. John Adams, second president of the United States. He believed that our Constitution was based on the Bible. It was a moral and it could only work with a moral and religious people. Our government is supposed to operate by ourselves governing our own selves. You know, I've got a copy here of the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution. And some of this is commentary on it. This is everything our country's based on. You know, we just wrote recently a church constitution, and people were saying, well, let's add this, and let's add that, and let's put some more, you know, and the less you got, sometimes the better it is. This is our constitution. It's founded on God. God is not mentioned in the constitution. People will get you on this. God's name is not mentioned in the constitution, except at the end where they all sign their names, and it says there in the year of our Lord, in 1787, they all signed this thing. In the year, and they don't say A.D., they say in the year of our Lord on such and such a date in September, in the year of our Lord. Well, the Lord is Jesus Christ. And you've got to understand that the Declaration of Independence that does talk about God and refer to him several times predates the Constitution, so That was the document that officially told everybody we were separating ourselves from England and why we were separating ourselves. So the Constitution didn't need to repeat that. The Constitution was laid on the foundation of the Declaration of Independence. The founders of our country realized that power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely, so they wanted us to be self-governing. And they didn't want a stronger federal government where they told us everything that we could do. They wanted a limited federal government. They knew they needed a federal government, but they wanted it to be limited. The United States Constitution is the only over 200-year-old country that still has its original Constitution. We're not an old nation or an old civilization, but we have the oldest Constitution still active in the world today. And why is that? Because it's been venerated. It's been honored. It's been cherished. This was the law of the land, the supreme law of the land. It's not perfect. In fact, even the writers who wrote it said, we know it's not perfect, but it's the best thing we got. So we're going to make ways to change it. We're not going to appoint judges who say, oh, I don't like that part. We're just going to change that. We're going to change this, and we'll go flip this out. No. We will change it by amendments to the Constitution. That's Article 5 of the Constitution. Only 7 articles in the Constitution. Article 5 talks about amendments. How do you change the Constitution? Well, 2/3 of the houses of Congress have to vote to make an amendment to the Constitution. We've had 27 of them. Last one was in 1992. 2/3 of the House and the Senate have to vote, and then they send it. 2/3 of the House or the Senate have to vote to do it, or 2/3 of the states can call a constitutional convention, and they can propose an amendment to the Constitution, either way. But then it goes before the states, and 3/4 of the states have to ratify that amendment. So you just can't flippantly change the Constitution. Why? Because it's the supreme law of the land. And you don't want people just saying, well, hey, we feel a little different today. I got up, my stomach, you know, I was just, you know, I feel, let's change it. No. It's hard to change for a reason. You need to think about it and pray about it and put a lot of effort into it before you go changing it. Then it takes 3/4 of the states once the Congress ratifies or once the Congress proposes the amendment, 3/4 of the states have to ratify it. That's 38 out of 50 states. 38 states have to ratify the amendment to the Constitution. 7 articles, 27 amendments. Oh, I'm running out of time. Bill of Rights, 10 amendments. The first 10 amendments, Bill of Rights, were added because the people were scared that the federal government was going to get too much control, so they said that we're not going to sign that thing until you promise that we're going to go back and have a congressional session and we're going to add some amendments. So they added 10. These rights are individual liberties and should not be abridged. Brings us to the question, who gives us our rights? Constitution and the Bill of Rights talk about our rights, but they're very clear. Declaration says, who gives us our rights? God. You're endowed by your Creator with certain unalienable rights, not the state. And this is a problem today. Many people, I think, are falling into the trap that they believe we get our rights from Washington. And in a sense, we are. Because they're beginning to infringe upon our liberties and our freedoms in many ways. Through the judiciary more than any other part of the government. You know, if you don't have God giving you your rights, then your rights are going to be given you by another human being. Whoa. And that can lead down the wrong path quickly. We need to know that there's an almighty God and he's in charge, and those that we elect are just under him, and they need to realize they're under him, and they're responsible to him, and they don't endow rights. The government is here to secure our rights, to make sure our rights are not violated. That's what the Constitution, Declaration's all about. This is what the Declaration says. It's the roadmap for the Constitution. We hold these truths to be self-evident. All men are created equal. They're endowed by their Creator, certain unalienable rights, and among these are life, liberty, pursuit of happiness. That secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed. In essence, the people are to govern everybody. They're to govern the government. Self-evident, common knowledge, duh. That's what they're saying. All men are created equal. Well, there was slavery, and women didn't get the right to vote. Yeah, I didn't say they followed it all right. They didn't have to go back and change it, though. They did add an amendment, three amendments, but it was already there. All men are created equal. They were just having a problem deciding who was a man and who wasn't a man. They had the same problem they got today, House Bill 2. They're endowed by their Creator. It's a gift. It's a gift. Government doesn't give it to you. God gives it to you. Unalienable. You can't take them away. Nobody, no president, no Congress, no Supreme Court can take away your rights, or they're not supposed to. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. You know, in the original, one of the original writings, they said the pursuit of the ability to hold property. And they changed it to pursuit of happiness. But what they meant by happiness was you know, to set your goals and try to achieve your goals and to pursue them. And we've turned that around today that everybody ought to be happy. So we ought to give everybody something to make them happy. And when you give somebody something, you got to take away from somebody else to make them happy. That's not what they intended. They intended for us to have an equal playing field where you can go out and become president of the United States or the CEO of whatever company if you want to and try hard enough and do it. You got a level playing field. And That's not perfect either, but hey, of all the countries in the world, I would dare not put ours up. I would dare put ours up against. By the consent of the government. We're a people by, of, and for the people, a government. The government derives their rights from the people. Thomas Jefferson. People like to say Thomas Jefferson was a deist. I do not believe he was a born-again believer in Jesus Christ, but I believe he believed in the Bible. People say, well, he cut out parts of it. Yeah, he did. If you really read that, though, he cut out parts to sort of make a summary of the Bible. And people say, well, he cut out the supernatural parts. No, he didn't. No, he didn't. He didn't cut them all out. He was just making him a shorter Bible so that he could get the main points, a summary. Cliff Notes. Y'all remember Cliff Notes? On the Bible. God gave us, the God who gave us life gave us liberty. And can the liberties of a nation be thought secure when we have removed their only firm basis? The only firm basis for our liberties is the conviction in the minds of the people that these liberties are the gift of God. That they are not to be violated, but with his wrath. He's the one that's quoted so much about separation of church and state because he wrote it in a letter. It'd been around, that phrase had been around for a little while, but he wrote it in a letter. But what he was saying, he was assuring some Baptist preachers that the government wasn't going to get in their business. That's what he was assuring them. There's a wall of separation. The government cannot go into the church and tell the church what to do. Life, liberty are synonymous. Can't have life unless you got liberty. Life and liberty come from God. Humans, as humans, we have to have someone who is higher than we are to give us our rights. Because if we elect someone to give us our rights, he's not perfect. And he's going to abuse our rights, abridge our rights at some point, sometime, someplace. This is what happens in communist governments, in dictatorships, kings. They will take your rights away. Rights come from God. God must have his rightful place in politics. Now, I'm going to mention something to you. I'm getting political. I don't care. I'm 66 years old. Get rid of me. Put me out to pasture. Democrat Party this summer had their national convention. They had no reference to God in it at all. There was an uproar in the media. And Republicans, of course, loved it. All right. So they came and attacked them. So they decided to put it, before the convention was over, they decided to put it into the platform. They had a vote of acclamation, said all in favor of putting God back in and Jerusalem as the capital of Israel, say yay, and yay! Everybody against say no, nay! Now you look it up on YouTube. They did it three times. First, the chairperson said, oh, wait a minute. They wanted to just ramrod it through. They did this in 2012. They ramrodded it through. So they do it three times. Every time, to my ear, sound like the A's were equal with the nays. And then the chairperson said, the A's have it. But it had to pass by a two-thirds vote. It was clearly not a two-thirds vote. Republicans have it in their platform 12 times. What's a platform? Platform is basically what the party wants to promote and do. Not every candidate has to support the platform, but, you know, this is a group of people in both parties. Brings us to the questions of rights or entitlements. And we're getting blurred on this and confused today. There's a lot of confusion. I got to go through with this. Rights have been broadened to mean a lot of different things. Listen, your freedoms are what's listed in the Constitution, the Bill of Rights. Freedom of speech, freedom of religion, freedom to bear arms. It's not just talking about militias either. It's talking about the freedom from seizure of your property, freedom from somebody breaking into your house, freedom of government troops coming in and taking over. Freedom, that's the freedoms it's talking about. Freedoms. Nobody can take your rights from you. Freedom to pursue education, freedom to vote, freedom to earn a paycheck, freedom to get some health care. A right is not an entitlement. We switched it around because we all need to have happiness, not the pursuit of happiness. So we as a nation turn these around and So we say, not only should I have the right to buy guns, somebody should buy me some guns. That's an entitlement. A freedom is the right to bear the gun. An entitlement is somebody needs to buy me some guns. I don't have enough money and I need to protect myself. I don't know who's going to propose that amendment. A freedom is, I don't have health care, you give me some. A freedom is, I don't have a paycheck, give me one. An entitlement. I don't have a house, give me a house. I don't have an education, give me the money to get an education. We're crossing some lines there. Government has no right to take one person's property or goods and give it to another. I'm not saying don't believe in taxes. But used to, when this country was founded, it was the charitable organizations that did these things. The right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness is not an entitlement or a guarantee of happiness. It gives you the right to pursue it. The government's role is to secure our rights and make it an equal playing field. Our forefathers rebelled against King George III because he was taking away their rights in their mind's eye. Our Constitution is a moral document. I want to read to you the preamble of the Constitution. Hopefully you learned this at some point in your life. We, the people of the United States, in order to perform a more perfect union, establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our posterity, do ordain and establish the Constitution of the United States. Well, a preamble is like the foreword, and it's like telling you what the rest of the document's going to be about, basically. What is it about? A perfect union. They want the states to come together, complete union. They want all the states to come together. They've been divisive and each one looking out for themselves, and they wanted them to come together and create a unified federal government that they could all agree. Establish justice for all, a level playing field. Everybody would be just from the richest to the poorest. Never really been true in our country. I'd say it's less true today than it's ever been. The rich, if you got money, you can get out of anything. Shouldn't be that way. Justice for all. Ensure domestic tranquility. That's an environment to pursue happiness. That's an environment, you know, to pursue life and to enjoy it. The Bible says, we're going to read that in just a minute, to pray for those in authority that we might have peace so we can do the things God's called us to do. Provide for the common defense. That's one of the jobs. These are the jobs of the United States government, the federal government. You know, an army and a navy and forces to defend us and make treaties and, you know, make war if necessary. Promote the general welfare. This does not mean everybody needs to be on welfare and food stamps. This means promote the general good of the people. We don't want to impede the people. We want them to be able to do what God has given them the ability to do. By the way, the Democratic Convention put in there, when they inserted God, they put it was God-given potential. Everybody should be able to use their God-given potential. I was glad they did it. So that we can secure the blessings of liberty. That's the government's here so that we can secure these blessings. As I said, people say God's not in the Constitution. It says on the 7th day of September in the year of our Lord, Jesus, it doesn't say Jesus, but in the year of our Lord, 1787. At the convention, Benjamin Franklin said we need to have prayer every day. At the Constitutional Convention, when they were all arguing and fussing, and most of the members of the Constitution said it is a miracle this thing got passed, because a lot of them took their ball and went home, you know, and it's a miracle that it even got written and signed, and all the state's representatives signed it ultimately. It's a miracle. Benjamin Franklin stands up, who some people say was a deist, who really didn't believe in a God who was active. And Benjamin Franklin says, we know that God knows when a sparrow falls from the heavens. We know that God knows the hair on our heads. Now, that is not a deist God. That's a creator God. And he says, I have found in my 81 years that what we need to do is, it behooves us to go to God in prayer. So I recommend that every day before we start this constitutional assembly, we pray. And they started doing it after that. So if you don't think the Constitution was based on God, wait a minute. So many of them said, We wouldn't even have a constitution if it weren't for God. It's all predicated upon the Declaration of Independence anyway. Now I'm going to get in politics one more time here for you. Saw the article about the video about the justices. Article 3 of the Constitution designates what the judicial branch is about. And it's kind of vague in a way. Our two candidates for president, one is in the record book. It's not, don't worry about what she says. She's in the record book. She likes activist judges. She might say she likes the Constitution, but her record shows that she believes that it's somewhat antiquated and it needs to be a living document, which means we need to be able to change it without amendments. Whoever comes on this court is going to stay there for a while unless God takes them away. If we get another two or three more judges who don't support the Constitution and believe it is a document that needs to be secure and sacred, we're in trouble. They have already struck down state laws about prayer, about Bible reading in public school, about abortion, about the definition of marriage, about sodomy. States had laws, and the Supreme Court had not the Congress, not necessarily the president, but the Supreme Court said, can't do that anymore. Nowhere is it mentioned in the Constitution that they have this authority or power over these things. They like to pull it around and shift it, but Donald Trump has said he's going to appoint constitutional judges, judges who believe in the Constitution. Is Donald Trump always truthful?
No.
I think God's put us in this place, in this time, with these two candidates, to see if we'll get on our knees and pray and seek his face. Because neither one of them are going to solve all our problems. And the government is there because of the consent of the people. And we've got to start standing up. We've got to pray. We've got to get ourselves right so that God will hear our prayer. We need to repent. When I talk to you about revival, I'd love to see the whole church revived. I'd like to see the whole country awakened. But I say all the time, you've got to work on yourself first. You get revived and then see what happens to the people around you. Don't just say it can't happen. What you're saying to me is, I can't get revived. Because if you get revived, somebody else is going to get revived. And if we all got revived, there's a lot of more people that are going to get revived. So quit making excuses. Study the Word of God. Quit playing with it. Hide it in your heart that you might not sin against God. I'm going to go on down the list here. Roy Cooper is running for governor. Roy Cooper was our attorney general. He made a pledge to support our and defend our Constitution of the state of North Carolina. And he did not do so on a couple of occasions. The law or the amendment that was voted on, the amendment was voted on, definition of marriage by 61% of the people. And our attorney general, because he did not like the law, and I can understand he might not like the law, and he has a right not to like the law, but he had a duty to defend our law and our amendment, and he said, I don't want to do it, and I'm not going to do it, because I don't like it. And you want him to be your governor, okay. I'm not going to go any further. I'll stop there. Study the Word of God. Know the Word of God. Read your Constitution. Read your Declaration of Independence. Understand what the founders intended, and as we let more and more people come in through the judiciary, through the Congress, through the executive branch, and start telling us and dictating with devoid of a faith and a trust in the Constitution and a desire to obey the Constitution, we're going to have more and more of our liberties taken away. But regardless of who's elected, you know, you can elect all Democrats, you can elect all Republicans, you can elect all Libertarians. I'm telling you, God's put this us in this place in history for a moment such as this. He's put you here. It's time for us to stand up. It's time for us to pray. It's time for us to seek his face. It's time for us to love and be patient and kind with everybody we meet and share the gospel. Shared the gospel with my barber this week. This is Paul's admonition, I believe, for times like this, every time. I exhort, first of all, that supplication, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings and all who are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and reverence. The only one who can give us this is God. Do you need to pray for President Obama? You betcha. You need to pray for Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump. Yeah. Definitely. You know, I'm praying God's going to do something. I am praying God's going to change somebody's heart. God's going to work in somebody's life, and they're going to get it. Boom. Pray for your kings. They were even supposed to pray for King George III, weren't they? I don't know how many of them did. Hopefully, a lot of them did. Come on, you're through. I'm through. No, I'm sorry. I got impassioned. Main thing, if you want to be a good, responsible citizen, oh, you vote, you study, you do all that, but you know the Word of God. And you apply the Word of God in your life. And that means you apply the Word of God in the way you vote. You don't vote because I've always been one of these colors and I've always been. That's not why you vote, based on the Word of God, on the Bible. Well, they're a nice person, but they got a lot of experience. All that can be advantageous, but if they're not living or saying they want to abide by the Bible or believe that the Bible is true or make some reference to that, that's how we vote. We vote the way God would have us to vote. Well, how would God have me to vote? God would have me to vote biblically. That's the key. The power of your love. Oh, we need the power of His love right now. Please stand with me. And I'm telling you, if you're not in the Word like you need to be, now is the time to repent. Confess your sins and get in it. And you need, when you repent, you need to tell somebody, hey, I'm going to make a change. I'm going to start doing better by the power of His love.
Draw me to your side.
might have been a lousy sermon. I don't know, but I didn't see anybody come down to dedicate themselves to studying the Word of God and hiding it in their heart. So I hope you've made those decisions in your heart where you sit. And I hope you tell somebody so that you'll have somebody to help hold you accountable. And we really get serious about the Bible. If we say we believe it like we say we believe it, we need to know it and encourage one another. I'm not trying to put a guilt trip on you, but I do want you to feel a little shame if you don't know it like you should. Remember your care cards. Let's pray. Father God, thank you for your word. It is truth. And Lord, forgive me. I don't study like I should. I don't pray like I should. I don't love people like I should. Don't love you as I should. Don't love my wife as I should. Lord, don't even love my dog as I should. And don't even have a dog, Father. But Lord, thank you for your grace. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your love. Lord, help us. Help you turn our country back. Help us to be an instrument in turning our country back to you, Lord. It's hopefully still not too late. Lord, we pray for our upcoming elections. I pray for Ms. Clinton. I pray for Mr. Trump and Mr. Cooper and McCrory and all of them, Father. I just pray that your will is going to be done. You're going to be glorified in all of it, be exalted. Help us not put our faith in a human being, but our faith is in you, as the founders said it needed to be. Father, go with us now. Help us to make a difference in our world. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
No, we don't do. We can do all.